If you're a Christian, we're living in a difficult world, like Noah did, like Lot did. Okay, we're living in a difficult world, but Jesus said, you're going to escape it. I'm going to come in the days of business as usual with a very evil world, and I'm going to take my remnant out, just like I did with Lot, just like I did with Noah. 30% of the Bible is full of prophecy. 30%. Now, if prophecy wasn't important, why would God tell us so much about the future? Mm-hmm. And most of that 30% is about the times that we're living in, the end times. So, and you say, well, why would God say so much about the time we're living in? It's going to be the worst time in human history. We see what's happening in the world today. Jesus said, pestilences and earthquakes and famines, that's just the birth pangs. That's not the birth yet. And so now what we're seeing right now is intensifying when women have babies.
Yes.
They begin to have birth pangs, but they get closer together and more severe. What we're seeing right now, since Israel became a nation in 1948, which actually started the end time clock, we've seen an intensity in birth pangs. And so today's world, I've never seen anything like this COVID-19 thing. I've never seen what's happening in the world right now, the unrest, the famines, pestilences, killer hornets. I mean, it's crazy.
Yeah.
And so it's just apocalyptic. But these are just the birth pangs. And so I believe the greatest thing, well, first of all, this is going to be, especially the last 7 years, the worst time in human history. We won't be here for that. And I want to comfort everybody with that. But the second thing is more people are alive today than have ever lived in human history combined. If you go from Adam to before this generation, we have almost 8 billion people alive right now. So the reason that God gave us end time prophecy was to help a huge number of people navigate the most severe time in human history. And the beautiful thing about prophecy, when you understand it, you can contextualize what's happening. If I were not a Christian, I think I would be terrified right now. In fact, Jesus said, when the end came, men's hearts would be failing them for fear. And that word fear is the Greek word phobos, and it also means terror. Jesus prophesied terrorism in the end times. And so I believe people right now are committing suicide over COVID-19. There's no doubt about it. Mental health, many people are depressed and discouraged. And this is widespread all around the world. And so Jesus talked about that. But when you understand the end times, I believe I have an understanding of it. When you understand the end times, Jesus said, look up. When you see these things begin to happen, don't get down. Don't get depressed. Look up. Your redemption is drawing near. So my takeaway from this is, if you truly understand Bible prophecy, you're going to end this program. You're not going to go and buy guns and food and get in a bunker. Is you're going to understand that Jesus Christ is coming to take His bride, the church, to be with Him. And as the world is going through 7 years of the wrath of the Lamb, and that's what it's called in Revelation 6, we're going through 7 years of the marriage supper of the Lamb. And so Jesus said, pray that you may be worthy to escape all these things that are going to come to pass and to stand before the Son of Man. Why would Jesus tell us to pray that we could escape? The word escape there means escape. It means get out. Jesus said, my coming will be like the days that Lot went out of Sodom and Gomorrah. Okay, he was saying, my return will be just like the day that Lot went out. He didn't say, pray that you may be worthy to endure all these things. He said, pray that you may be worthy to escape. So I believe that we're living in a time prior to the rapture, the return of Jesus for His church. I believe these are severe times, but it's nothing compared to the tribulation.
Yeah.
The rider on the pale horse in Revelation 6 kills a quarter of mankind. Okay, right now there'd be almost 2 billion people. In Revelation 9, three plagues kill a third of mankind. In Revelation 16, all sea life is dead. And a star called wormwood hits the earth and decimates the earth. In Luke 17, the coming of the Son of Man will be like the days of Noah, buying, selling, marrying, giving in marriage. We're living in those days right now.
Mm-hmm.
Noah was building his ark. He was an idiot. He had this huge ark on dry land. There was it had never rained. He had no trailer to pull it to the lake. I mean, he's just sitting there on dry, and he was an idiot until the rain started.
Yeah.
And when he was on the ark and the rain started, this idiot became a genius. And I'm saying your friends may make fun of you, or your family may make fun of you, or other people may make fun of you. But I'm telling you, when the rapture comes, you're going to be a genius when you're prepared for that day. But Jesus said it's going to be business as usual. Okay, so let's go to the end of the tribulation. And in Matthew 24, by the way, Jesus describes a rapture at the end of the tribulation. He said, immediately following the tribulation of those days, the Son of Man will come, gather the elect from the four corners. That's the rapture for people who got saved during the tribulation, because there will be millions, if not billions, of people that get saved during the tribulation. At the end of the tribulation, Jesus said, unless those days had been cut short, no flesh would have survived. it, Luke 17, he said, it'll be like buying and selling, marrying and giving in marriage, like the day that Lot went out of Sodom and Gomorrah, just, you know, everybody mocking, everybody sinning. You can't get those two texts confused, because you have to understand, marrying and giving in marriage, buying and selling, planting and building, at the end of the tribulation, the earth is a smoldering ruin. Jesus said, those days will be so severe, if I didn't cut those days short, no human being would survive. Okay, Zechariah 14, by the way, described nuclear holocaust. And so you just have this situation in the Bible where it couldn't get better for a Christian. If you're a Christian, we're living in a difficult world, like Noah did, like Lot did. Okay, we're living in a difficult world, but Jesus said, you're going to escape it. I'm going to come in the days of business as usual with a very evil world, and I'm going to take my remnant out, just like I did with Lot, just like I did with Noah. Okay, however, if you're not ready, you're going to be here during the worst 7 years of human history, okay, that are described in the book of Daniel, that are described in the book of Revelation. Horrific, horrific. And so at the end of the tribulation, will there be buying and selling, marrying, giving in marriage? You won't be going to any weddings, but you'll be going to about 30 funerals a day. There will be human, there will not be enough room to bury 4 billion human bodies or more. And so we're living in the days prior to the return of Jesus, okay, the rapture of the church, prior to the tribulation, and every person who's a Christian, you're going to go. The only thing required to go on the rapture is just to know Jesus Christ. And so, and by the way, in Luke 17, Jesus said in Matthew 24, two men will be standing in the field, one taken, one left. And the word for taken there is the word paralambano in the Greek, and it means to receive into yourself. And you say, well, why would Jesus, and describe, and this is a selective rapture, Jesus knows who belongs to him. Okay, so why would Jesus use the word paralambano in that text to say taken, okay? Because in John 14, he said to the disciples, I'm going away to my Father's house, and I'm going away to prepare a place for you. And if it were not true, I would have told you. And as surely as I go away to prepare a place for you, I'm going to come back and take you, paralambano, to be with me so that where I am, you can be also, and you'll be with me forever. And so Jesus today is at his Father's house, the New Jerusalem, okay? Jesus is at his Father's house, and he's preparing a place for us. When a Jewish couple got married, they were betrothed. They weren't married, but it was legal. They were betrothed, and they had a glass of wine. And when they finished having the glass of wine, the groom would say to the bride, I will not drink this again until I drink this with you in my Father's house. And he would go to his Father's house. The bride would stay in her house. She had to sleep in her wedding dress, and all the bridesmaids had to sleep in their wedding clothes. Okay, and she had to keep a lamp because the groom always came at night, or almost always came at night. So the groom would go back to his Father's house and build a huppah, build a wedding chamber. And when he was finished building the wedding chamber, he could not go back to get his bride. It was typically about a year. He couldn't go back and get his bride without his Father's permission. Jesus said, no, I don't know the day or the hour. Only my Father knows. If it took the average Jewish man a year to prepare a place for his bride, Jesus had been gone 2,000 years. Can you imagine what that place is going to be like? So Jesus is preparing a place for every single person watching right now. If you're a believer, he's preparing a place. And as surely as he left, he's going to return. Okay, this is the importance about the teaching of the return. Jesus promised he was going to return. Mm-hmm. I'm going away. I'm going to return. And when the groom returned, he had the friends of the bridegroom that came with him, and they blew trumpets, and they shouted as they arrived at the bride's house, and the bride would get up in her wedding clothes, had her lamp lit, and she and her wedding party would return to his house, and they had a seven-day wedding. The Jewish wedding lasted 7 days. And so 7 years in heaven, 7 days. And so Jesus promised that he was going to come back and take us. And the word paralambano that he used in John 14 is exactly the same word he uses there in Luke 17 and Matthew 24. We're waiting for the return of Jesus to take us to be with him forever and to marry him in his Father's house. At the Last Supper, he had a glass of wine with the disciples. And he said, I won't do this again until I do it with you in my Father's house.